Today I'm going to talk about the strength of cultural brands. I'm going to show you something about the technology, the technique that I have used to measure the strength of brands, and also will tell you briefly about how you can build the strength of brands. I'll use the following agenda for it. First of all, just a few words about myself, then common language about brands, so that we all share the same thoughts about what a brand is and what a brand not is. Then about the market research model Brand Alchemy, what I just mentioned, or what Professor Bijsterveld just mentioned. Then some results about marketing research, brand research. First about myself, and then using some brands. I was born in the city of Rotterdam, also studied in Rotterdam, and did some study also postgraduate at Groningen. Then I went to some companies. I was a brand manager there and a marketing manager at KPN, Henkel and Grolls. KPN is a telecom organization, Henkel is a German multinational, and Grolls, maybe you know, but now you know, it's a beer brand. Then I went into brand consultancy 10 years ago, and 7 years ago I became a brand consultant on my own. An independent brand consultant. I'm working with a couple of universities, and what I already said, I'm really proud to be here now and to be in Venice. About brands now, I would like to discuss with you what a brand is. Some brand terminology I would like to discuss with you. And also, of course, talking about why it's important, I think, to build a strong brand. Of course, you know all these brands, I think. Is there somebody here who doesn't know one of those four brands? Okay, although, yeah, there's just one brand name presented, it's clear, okay, that those four brands, we don't have to discuss it. These are brands. These are strong brands. Talking about brands within the cultural sector, within the cultural industry, is not for everybody quite normal. About 10 years ago, it was the first time that I was in the Netherlands, I was invited for a congress about cultural organizations, and people were talking quite negatively about, or reacting quite negatively about my subject, about branding. That moment, people thought, okay, branding is something for profit organizations. It's about commercial things. It's not, for example, what I was teaching last week about sustainability, for example. Of course, I think it's possible also, or it's necessary for cultural organizations to build strong brands, but sometimes it's a bit new. Talking about brands, first of all, maybe a definition. And I would like to ask you, what is a brand according to you? Please tell me, help me. What is a brand? Could you please help me? Somebody who thinks, okay, this is a definition of a brand. I use quite a short definition of a brand. It's not the truth, but it's I think what works quite well. So it's a name with a reputation, and like you just said, if the brand is already there, so you're not talking about the brand name anymore. But then it's really only about reputation. So it's about the reputation you have at the moment and the reputation you would like to have. And the logos you see here. Many logos are typically Dutch, so you won't know them. But these logos are worked for. And I think the quite funny thing is that every sector, every industry thinks, okay, we are the best and we are the brander, the big branding companies or organizations. But actually, for all the organizations, I use the same methodology, and it works. Something else about brands. Brands should be unique, relevant, motivating. Have value. It's not only about function or emotion, it's about both. So every band should have functional values and emotional values. Otherwise, something is going wrong, because if a brand only has functional values, then it's quite easy for a competitor to go into the market and to have a bonding with a brand and take over the volume of its competitor. Also, quite an important thing is that products have life cycles, and brands, if you handle them, if you manage them in the right way, then a brand doesn't have a product life cycle. So it's a bit like this. So what you see over there on the slide is that you've got a product life cycle. So you develop the idea of a product. Then it's introduced, it's growing, it's getting mature, and then it declines. So if you are going to product or to introduce a new product on the right moment, then you can skip the former product, then you'll introduce another one, and so on and so on. And if you do it in the right way, in a consistent way, every time the product will go out of the market, a new product will come, and the brand is growing. And this sounds a bit like a commercial thing, so that it is Apple or it's McDonald's with a new burger or something like that. But exactly the same, you can tell about culture. It's, for example, a museum. Every time you've got a new exhibition, for example, every festival has a new program, or a theater has its new program. Every time, if you organize a new and innovative program, then you build brand. But the product will leave, yeah? More about brands. It's very important to build a brand. Also for cultural organizations, for several reasons. And actually you could make the summary that it's about money. Sometimes it's a bit disappointing that also culture is about money, but okay, it's the truth. Because also if your mission is only to make people happy about art, then you need money. So it's really necessary to build a strong brand to get the money. And if you have the money, or how do you get the money? It's with a brand, so that you can get more clients, more customers, more visitors. Also that you get higher price premiums. Expandability of supply. Just look at the picture. A guy who apparently visited the Van Gogh Museum. He's a bit tired of the museum visit, I think. But he bought a poster. And he only bought the poster, not because the picture was so beautiful, but because it's Van Gogh. So he went home and he was proud to be, let's say, a member of the Van Gogh Club. Negotiation power is also very important. So if you want to open a new museum, so, for example, in Venice, when somebody opened the Punta della Dogana, I think the person had some negotiating power. Not only money, he had negotiating power. Also because he had some experience with it, with Palazzo Grassi. But of course, he had it because he is a strong brand. He has a strong brand. Protection against new entrants to the market. If you really have a strong brand, other organizations are doubting, okay, can I come in the market or not? If you don't have a strong brand, I think, okay, I can take them. I can take their customers. And at the end, it's also internally, of course. It's nicer to work for a strong brand than for a weak brand. Okay, this is all about the brand owner, but of course it's also important for the client. Or if you're talking about cultural organizations, about the visitors. So simplify the choice of process. If you know Guggenheim, you've been there, for example, you've been there in New York, you've got the idea that if you go to Berlin and you visit another Guggenheim museum, it will be nice, it will be of high quality, it will be about contemporary or modern art. You know that this is okay, and if you only have time, 1 day or 2 days in Berlin to visit the several museums and cultural venues, then you go to something that you know on forehand that it is of high quality. So, yeah, linked to that, that it removes uncertainty, intrinsic value, that it has something to do with yourself, that you indulge yourself, for example, and extrinsic value, that it does something with your image. So if I'm now telling you that every year I'm going to the to La Biennale, that does something with you, I think. And at the other hand, if I tell you that every night I eat at McDonald's, also you've got a special idea about me. So it's about branding, and at this moment, or with this example, I took a commercial and a non-commercial example, but I could also say, okay, if I only go to Venice to go to see the Rialto Bridge and then I go back again, that also gives some idea about me and about, let's say, who I am. Yeah. In branding, it's not only fun in branding country, it's also hard stuff. So you've got quite a lot of terminology around branding, and I would like to discuss it with you briefly. And maybe before I do it, I would like to say to you that if you've got questions, just ask them, because it's nice for you, maybe, and nice for me. Just all questions you have, if it's not clear, but also if you just like to discuss a theme, just do it. We won't have to wait until the end of this presentation, yeah? These are all terms about branding, and I'll make some structure in it. Actually, it is about two things. On the top, it's about identity, and at the bottom is about positioning. So the identity, so the upper part of this slide, is about what you are at the moment, so what the brand is at the moment, and the other side is what you would like to be the brand. So the brand heritage, it's the history. Every time when you're working with a brand, when you're working on a brand, look at the history of the brand, because it's very, very interesting to know why has somebody started this brand. Every time when I'm working for a client, I'm always asking them, why did they do this? And quite often they don't know it. And quite often if you ask them and you get the information, it's a very, very interesting starting point to rebuild the brand, to strengthen the brand again, because most of the times the basis of the brand, the essence of the brand is there. So the brand essence, it's about the core associations, the brand assets, the tangible things. So I just showed you the logo of Grolsch, the beer brewery where I was working for. So the flip-top bottle is really one of the assets of the brand of Grolsch. Without that bottle, Grolsch wouldn't be really differentiated. Brand identifiers, as logos. Then on the other part, brand positioning, it's about proposition. So why are people preferring my brand compared to other brands? Brand values, it's about emotions and brand personality. Let's say that's the tone of voice. So if at the one hand, you know what you are, and at the other hand, that you decide, okay, I want to be that for these people, then you're going to combine them. And there's the difficult part, that you really make clear, okay, on this point the brand is going well, and the other points I really have to work on it. So that's the point that I've got my business, to help people to make clear what's going well and what's not going well. Okay, to get some interaction, question about the brand Amsterdam. What are your associations with the brand Amsterdam? Could you please tell me? Or don't you dare, because I'm living in Amsterdam. Just tell me. Also, if it is negative. There are positive and negative associations around Amsterdam. Freedom and coffee shops. Never heard of before. More? Sorry? Venice of the North. Oh, beautiful. More associations. Flowers. And especially tulips, I think. Yeah, okay. More associations. No? Okay, these are the associations, yeah? The red light district. Okay, oh, everybody had the association but didn't dare to say it. Okay, it's clear. And then about Venice. So you could also say that it's Amsterdam of the south, or not? No? okay, Venice is unique. More about Venice, the brand Venice. No?
High water.
Sorry?
High water.
High water, okay. Spritz, yeah? Art, yeah? Pigeons? Pigeons? Oh, okay. Yeah, okay. It's really I know what a pigeon is, but never thought about. Yeah, okay. Yeah, it's an interesting association. You also have pigeons in Amsterdam. Loads you've got. Yeah. Okay. Oh, okay. So you are the pigeon killer. Okay. So okay, these are the. These are the associations. Also some facts, and it's quite nice. So let's say that is the image of these two cities, and then some of the facts, and there are of course some similarities, and maybe also because of that Amsterdam is called Venice of the North. So it's both are capitals. One of a little country, so you could also call the Netherlands a region. So Venice is a capital of a region. Venice, of course, has a very, very rich maritime history. The Netherlands also. It's a big port. Still have number four in Europe. Of course, both have canals. Both have a UNESCO World Heritage List ranking. And both are quite focused on tourists. But at the end, I think the positioning of Venice and the positioning of Amsterdam is quite different. You can react on this, but in my opinion, the positioning of the city of Venice is about beauty, so la bellezza. And if you're talking about Amsterdam, the first thing what was said, it's about freedom, or you could also say it a bit more direct, or in a bit different way, equal opportunities for all, so about tolerance. And let's say this is the positive thing of the two cities, the positive proposition of the two cities, but you could also think about, okay, these associations, and this is, maybe it is the desired direction of the two brands. What are the potential threats? In my opinion, if you look at the brand of Venice, there are some threats. Loss of relevance, because of lacking a link with the present. Actually, that is a bit too much an open-air museum. And at the other hand, of course, Amsterdam, loss of sympathy, and also loss of tolerance, loss of excellence. Because when you're talking about coffee shops, when you're talking about drugs, and the thing that's not here on the board, but also about the red light districts, it's not only sympathy, it's not only excellence, it's the negative thing of it. So these are, I think, the threats, but of course you can react on it. And I think to avoid it and to strengthen the brand, for example, for Venice, it is really very important that it's not only about the history. So Punta della Dogana, Palazzo Grazzi, Capesero, La Biennale. These brands are, in my opinion, very, very important to strengthen the brand. That there is also urgence. So for me, for example, that every year there is something new, there is something exciting to go to, because otherwise I could go to Lisbon or I could go to London or something like that. I used to work, for example, for the Amsterdam Tourist Board, and they're spending millions to get your visitors, the visitors of Venice. And all the cities are just trying to attract these visitors. So I think for Venice, these initiatives are very important. And at the other hand, if you really, as a city of Amsterdam, want to realize the brand strength around tolerance and about excellence, Anne Frank House is very, very important. That is about tolerance, it's about anti-discrimination and so on. Van Gogh Museum, for everybody, I think, here in the room, everybody knows Van Gogh, everybody knows the museum. But also the Amsterdam Gay Pride, something about tolerance, what's quite differentiating for the city of Amsterdam. But at the other hand, it's not about culture only. Amsterdam also, that's the capital of Philips, for example. Okay, it was about, let's say, branding in general. Then I would like to show you something about doing brand research and also give you some examples and show you why brands, cultural brands, are so strong. Okay, a lot of text, but I can tell you briefly. Together with the University of Amsterdam, I've built up a brand research model. It's called Brand Alchemy, but it's not very important. In quite a lot of industries, it works. So not only the cultural brands are measured, but also in sponsoring, also in, for example, the city brands. And what's quite interesting is to make comparisons. And for example, for chasing the sponsors for cultural organizations, it's interesting to know, okay, am I a stronger brand than you sponsor brand? And one of the conclusions of this brand research is that many cultural organizations have more brand strength than sponsor brands, than really the big Dutch corporations. But I'll show you. First of all, something about how the brand research model works. It measures in three steps how strong it is. It's about awareness, it's about esteem, and it's about bonding. So first of all, just do you know the name or not? The second step is, do you know what I'm doing? And if you know, do you admire it? Do you have esteem for it? And the third step is bonding. Do you really feel bonded? And if you look at it at a let's say a national level, then it's really that it is an institute. I'll show it later, but I also can say it now, that Anne Frank House, for example, that's really a national institute. So everybody knows it, a really very, very high, and of course, positive evaluation, and the bonding is very, very high. It's really part of our history and part of our, let's say, national pride. If you've measured the strength of a brand, then you also want to know, okay, why am I so strong as a brand? And for that, there are brand personality factors and brand performance factors. So there you already see again that it's about function and it's about emotion. So brand personality is the emotion and brand performance, it's the function. First of all, I would like to show you something about the results of the city's brand research. And maybe it's not really a surprise, and could also be that the other city brands are not really familiar to you. But Amsterdam is really, it's by far, it's the strongest city brand of Holland. Maybe interesting, or more interesting, is that let's say the ranking of brand strength and the ranking of the number of residents, there's really not that much, there are not so many similarities between the two. So with Amsterdam, yeah, it's the biggest city and it's also the strongest brand. But for example, Maastricht only has about 100,000 residents. Rotterdam, for example, it's if you are looking at the number of residents, it's the number two city of the Netherlands. But people don't like it, although it's my city. Something more. Based on correlation analysis, also looked, okay, which factors are most important to build a strong brand? And maybe it's a bit disappointing, but if you're looking at let's say, the average Dutchman, then a good city, an attractive city, has good shops, pleasant atmosphere, good restaurants, easy exit. And then at the fifth and the sixth place, then only at the fifth and the sixth place, it's about, let's say, about culture, it's about art. Then you get number five, attractive buildings, attractive architecture, so more or less it's about a historical center. And number six, it's about attractive range of museums. And going back for a while to the positioning of Amsterdam and the weaknesses of Amsterdam, you can see something what quite interesting is, I think. If you see the pleasant atmosphere, there Amsterdam is not on the first place. Actually, it's on the fourth place. But for example, on the ranking for attractive range of museums and all the other ones that are important to build a strong city brand, Amsterdam is on the first place. I already told you that brand personality is very important to build a strong brand, that people really know you, okay, that's the tone of voice, that's the sympathy of the brand. Being likable, being active and being unique, these three factors based on correlation analysis seems to be the most important factors. And then again, if you look at the ranking of the city of Amsterdam, and maybe it's not surprising anymore, Amsterdam is not the most likable city of the Netherlands. It's on the number three position. So once again, you can see, based on market research, that there are some problems for the brand of Amsterdam. Unfortunately, I don't have the figures for Venice. It would be nice, but maybe next time. I'll make the link to the cultural brands research. And first of all, what I did was taking the top 150 of strongest brands of the Dutch cultural sector. And then the city of Amsterdam is absolutely the number one. About 40% of all strong cultural brands are located in Amsterdam. And these are the organizations. These 19 organizations of about the 60 are the organizations that are really very strong brands. And I don't think surprising. The Anne Frank House is really the strongest brand. Does everybody know the Anne Frank House? Yeah? Okay. Maybe for some of you, it sounds a bit disrespectful to talk about a brand if you're talking about the Anne Frank House. But I think it's very important, also for the Anne Frank House, that they are thinking about branding. Because the visitors of the city of Amsterdam, they all are thinking about, okay, am I going to the Anne Frank House or am I going to Madame Tussauds or am I going to Rijksmuseum? So they have to know whether they're still a strong brand. And it's not about money, that's just about the mission of the Anne Frank House, their mission about tolerance. And it would be really a big problem if people get more interested in Madame Tussauds instead of Anne Frank House. And that's why I think it's really very important that they know things like this. And I'm happy that a strong brand like the city of Amsterdam, it's weaker than the Anne Frank House, and all city brands of the Netherlands are weaker than the very, very strong brand Anne Frank House. I also make the comparison with the sponsor brands, and there are only two sponsor brands of Holland that are stronger than the Anne Frank House brand. Douwe Egberts, it's a coffee brand, Albert Heijn is the most popular supermarket chain of the Netherlands. There are stronger brands than Anne Frank House, but all other sponsor brands are weaker. Then at the end, it's also interesting for cultural organizations to make the comparison I already mentioned between their strength and the strength of sports brands, because 90% of sponsoring goes to sponsoring and goes to sports brands and not, for example, to cultural brands. Then you can see that Anne Frank House is stronger than almost every sports brand of the Netherlands. Building strong brands within the museum industry, it's about, and that's also about correlation analysis, it's about building a strong educational program, international class, and high quality. So you already saw Rijksmuseum, Van Gogh Museum, and Frank House. It's all about these brands. They have a strong educational program, they are international class, and also they offer high quality. Okay, I'm almost finishing this presentation, and just briefly, I would like to introduce the methodology. And actually, it's really very logical. The methodology I follow when I'm doing a consultancy project with my clients. So building strong brands for cultural organizations. It's just following those four steps. So analysis, strategy, implementation, and monitor. We already talked quite a lot about analysis, about knowing what your reputation is now, and also to know, okay, that's the next step, knowing what you want to be. So knowing what you want to be, it's about mission, goals, positioning, brand architecture, where brand positioning is also very, very important, that you know who you are chasing, so which visitors you want to have. And of course, when you know what direction you want to go as a cultural brand, then it is a moment that you really can decide, okay, which exhibitions, so as a museum, which exhibitions are I going to develop and which aren't I developing anymore. So, for example, I'm working for most of the biggest museums in the Netherlands. Then we just, based on the strategy, we are going to decide, okay, we have to change the exhibition program, we have to change the communication program, or even we have to change the building, the interior of the building, for example. Because if you have decided that the brand positioning is focused on families with children, and, for example, you want to be really a trendy museum, that you really want to reach as much as people as you want as possible, okay, then you have to do something about your implementation. So then you have to be not highbrow but quite lowbrow. Then you really have to be an accessible program in exhibition. So that's the way that in a structured way you can change your program, and that counts for cultural organizations, but as well for cities or for corporations, of course. Now, if you've done that, then you can monitor it. And that's the last thing I would like to show you, something about monitoring. So something about doing research. And that's also part of strength of cultural organizations. Quite often, cultural organizations, they are proud of what they do. They are proud of what they show, and that's all. But step by step, it's getting more difficult to get the money to organize it, to get the subsidies for it, and so financing it. And then it's very interesting also to see the figures. And for example, now for about 100 cultural organizations in the Netherlands, I do research now, visitor research. And what you can see, for example, from that visitor research is what the economic effect is of cultural organizations. And if you see, for example, here the museums, so the entrance fee is not really interesting. So about not more than 6.5 euros, that's the entrance fee. but total expenditures. So just for eating, drinking, transportation, and so on, parking, then it's a factor of 6.6. So that's interesting. That's interesting just to go to the municipality, just to go to the government and say, okay, we are absolutely, we're interesting. We're not only strong brands, but also on the economic side of it, it's interesting. Even for festivals, it's more interesting. I did some research in Holland, and there the economic brand value was totally clear. For two festivals, and don't think you know them, but you can read the figures. You can don't think you can read the Dutch text beneath it, but that festivals have a value of 94 million and 75 million. So that you really can see, okay, based on brand strength and social cost minus social benefits, that the net profit of a festival is 94 euros or 75 million euros. That's really the basis to talk about brands in a totally different way, that people really get proud of it also in a, let's say, a society where it's going quite often only about money. Okay, I have some conclusions, but I think it's better to take this or to use this time for some questions. And first of all, I would like to give you the word. Yeah, Mrs. Carroll.
Heinrich Beerta's lecture is, of course, relevant not only to imagining Venice as a cultural brand, but is also relevant, of course, to my course at VIU Art in Exchange, which I teach. I've taught in the fall, and I'm teaching currently. And the theme is also especially timely in the fall when we explore cultural heritage and preservation more closely. We look at sites that are heavily touristed, such as the Skrovenyi Chapel, but also the Art and Architecture Biennale this fall in Venice. In fact, at the end of my course, we also examine the Biennale effect, and we consider the idea of global diversity and participation. We also contemplate the Biennale theme and its objective to offer a coherent viewing experience on a global level. The Biennale, among other institutions in Venice, being a contemporary art initiative such as the Punta della Dogana, as you mentioned, and Palazzo Grassi, would be one among several to be scrutinized in looking at the brand positioning of cultural institutions in Venice. So I wanted to digress for a moment and move to some practical examples in Venice. If we think about Venice as being beauty as the point to be focused on. So, for example, we go to a very practical level, which is not so much about beauty here, but as you see, the image that I've taken a shot of here is at the municipal level. If one just simply peruses the website, for example, of the City of Venice, on their website, you can clearly see their wishes, goals, under the heading of the trademark of Venice, as you see here. And they state that the City of Venice, the objective has been to create better conditions for inhabitants, not here on the screen, but also relations, let's say, between inhabitants and tourists in Venice, which would help to change this image of Venice on a global level. And so one of the initiatives was VeniceConnected.com, an official website for tourists that was launched in 2009, hoping to show tourists how easy it would be to book their stay in Venice year-round, with the hope of making the city more pleasant to residents as well as for tourists. Time will tell to see if this initiative works, since it's relatively new. But the key point here in mentioning VeniceConnected.com is that the assumption is that the resident population is considerable, and that Venice, of course, is a residential city. So regarding art, there are a number of examples currently that we can examine in Venice, one being the Galleria dell'Accademia. Since 2004, you don't see the building, it doesn't look like this today, but it's covered in scaffolding. But the idea was to augment the rather limited space, and the new facility will have a new lobby, a cafeteria, conference rooms, classrooms intended for museum studies, as well as a basement level. And the museum will also be connected to the interior courtyard, which was designed by Andrea Palladio. The entire structure was supposed to be reopened in 2009. That has not yet happened, but is nearing completion. We, so far, no precise reopening date has been announced, but it will remain interesting, remain to be seen, if brand positioning is on the minds of the Accademia Museum. Will it remain the same, or will it evolve? But I wanted to show you a parallel example of provoking and controversial museum, a recent case of the Kelvin Grove Art Gallery and Museum as a part of the Glasgow City Museums in Scotland. And very interesting, the director of research and development and policy made a very bold maneuver, and after extensive customer research was carried out, it was decided to target a different crowd. And I show you just a few examples of different displays that target different visitor groups. In fact, Kelvin Grove decided that they would focus on families, children under five, non-experts, and schools, school children from age 5 to 14. And the interpretation and labels, paneling information, the wall didactics in each gallery would include film as well as light interactive activities. Here's one. And here, of course, the Renaissance galleries, which are my personal favorite. Here, of course, you see in the lower image is one explaining Venice and Venetian painting, where you have Madonna and Child next to an excerpt from the Jacopo de Barbari map. Here's another where a Renaissance chapel is recreated, and you see Virgin or Holy Family scene with an explanation. And of course, this required software producers and furniture suppliers and conservators to ensure a precise interpretation, projections of the works of art. What's interesting is that in 2006, when Kelvin Grove reopened, it attracted about 3.2 million visitors in 1 year. It was ranked 14th in terms of world museum visits. 60% of the city's population of 600,000 inhabitants came on an average of about three times each. So as the public reaction was very mixed, it's interesting to note, and I point this out to you, that art critics, in particular from London, from the Burlington magazine, found that, quote, a quest for the lowest common denominator was what Kelvin Grove had achieved at their museum. That they simply went too far in, quote, essential art values. And I'd like to assert here that, being an art historian myself, I would argue that associating the lack of an art education with stupidity or ignorance is plain wrong. I would assert that art history is hardly a core subject that's taught in the schools, but on the other hand, cultural meanings can be learned, can be taught at the museum level. And currently, the Museum of the Metropolitan Museum of Art in New York faces a similar situation in the 21st century. So coming back to Venice, how can Venice maintain and communicate the exceptional strength of the city brand, Venice in Venice? It might be done at the museum level, but we should also consider that Italy is already a mega brand, when we think of European identities with regard to made in Italy, fashion, design, but Venice holds, of course, a very unique position in this. Historically, it's been known as La Dominante, La Serenissima, Queen of the Adriatic, City of Waters, City of Masks, City of Bridges, the Floating City, and City of Canals, and of course, the list goes on. Other contemporary cultural initiatives that might help to reposition Venice, or have, such as the Biennale, it places Venice at the center of a live discussion directing the debate on contemporary art, such as you've suggested with contemporary art initiatives, but also on a local level. It has attempted to bring in a residential community in Venice with the involvement of university programs, as well as school children. But in fact, the Biennale has been the subject of a study in 2009, and in terms of its efficacy in branding and the so-called brand wagon. Biennale material, as you see projected, this is typically posted on a local level, and it's typically very savvy with an intellectual play on the text. As you see, it's always specific to each year's theme. Excuse me, that's Punta, not Punto, della Dogana, is another interesting manifestation of a contemporary art center located in the former Customs House, as you see here in Venice, and it exhibits works of art from the collection of Francois Pinault. I'd like to conclude with this thought. Venice has recently decided to nominate itself as the European Capital of Culture. That is to say, the European Culture Capital has already designated Italy, as well as Bulgaria, to be their official cities in the year 2000.